The story of Titanic, the brief wonder of her sailing and the tragedy of her sinking, is only a chapter in the saga of North Atlantic crossings. As late as the mid-19th century, ocean voyages are grim necessities instead of pleasure cruises. English author Charles Dickens calls his Boston-bound ship not unlike a gigantic hearse with windows in the sides. Of his bunk, he writes, "Nothing smaller for sleeping in was ever made, except coffins." Even after commercial ships begin to sail on fixed schedules, passengers endure cramped, unsanitary conditions for up to a month. Food is bad, disease is rampant, and the sea is unpredictable. Of every 100 ships that set sail, 16 will never reach port, some disappearing without a trace. The North Atlantic may be harsh, but the world is getting smaller. Travel and mail between Europe and North America are increasing. By the late 19th century, technology and ship design are advancing to meet these needs, and shipbuilders focus on comfort, style, and speed. With each advance, the transatlantic run takes less time. Seeking to make the most of this trend, a Liverpool businessman named Thomas Henry Ismay legally incorporates the bankrupt White Star Line he bought in 1867. Financial backer Gustav Schwabe arranged the deal with one main stipulation: that Ismay work exclusively with the Belfast shipbuilding firm Harland & Wolff, partly owned by Schwabe's nephew. The new White Star orders 6 innovative liners. The first one is Oceanic, and she sails in March 1871.
Hey everybody, Romy online. So, thought I'd do something different today.
The new luxury liners are being built for a new kind of passenger. In their world, a dog arrives at...
Hold on 1 second, and I'll explain all this. So, this is Romy online, and we're doing today a little bit of Titanic 101. This is the Titanic Explorer from James Cameron. And let me see if I can fix this. The volume is on 1. So it's an idea of what's going on with the Titanic, and it was all created by James Cameron, and of course he had his writers on this and all that. So it's a little bit of history of the Titanic, but I'm just going to do this in intervals and keep VODs so that I can move it over to YouTube, because this is an amazing story. It's not necessarily a game, it's just literally information. So
arrives at a party in a $15,000 diamond collar. An elegant dinner is served entirely on horseback. Newfound wealth finds a new style during the Gilded Age, a name
we call them
by
Republicans.
American author and social critic Mark Twain to the last 3 decades of the 19th century. The industrialized Western world is secure and prosperous in the years following the American Civil War and the Franco-Prussian War. Poverty is still everywhere, but the growing middle class now enjoys leisure time, and the upper class flaunts its wealth. The great minds of science and business are speeding up a pulsing industrial beat that drowns out Mother Nature's slower, gentler rhythms. Progress is the new god for those who want to see results larger than life. Few think about the consequences.
Mm-hmm. So it's that day and age where a lot of people... It's normal to die in a...
This calls for a celebration.
Hey, it calls for a celebration.
Hi, Grant. How you doing? Increasing trade and emigration demand...
So let me explain a little bit. So obviously in the North Atlantic, there were tons of ships being messed up anyway. It said that out of the 100 ships that goes across the sea from, you know, Europe to the United States... You know, 16 of them never make it, and they disappear with, like, out of trace, you know? So the Atlantic is a pretty fierce element on this earth, and it's very challenging. At that time, even in those times of Titanic early designing stages, that it was still troublesome to have anything
and ships that will accommodate both steerage passengers and the thrill-seeking rich. In March 1887, Harland & Wolff lays the keels for 2 White Star ships that will be considered the first modern
ocean liners. Hey, Callum!
Big, fast,
hello,
and comfortable.
Hey, Grant.
Teutonic and majestic.
Hey, Callum.
10,000 tons each will reach a
Callum,
speed
this
of
is in your
knots,
neck of the woods.
Crossing the Atlantic in a mere 7.5 days. White Star's chief rivals the British Cunard Line and the German Hamburg-America Line must rise to the challenge.
This is crazy. A book that was made describing Titanic.
Not everyone is optimistic about the industrial race toward the 20th century. Morgan Robertson, an American writer and self-professed psychic, spins a cautionary tale in his 1898 novel, Futility. He tells of Titan, a huge ocean liner that strikes a North Atlantic iceberg one April night and sinks with great loss of life. The name, size, and speed of his ship are hauntingly similar to those of a liner that White Star will build 11 years later. This short novel, with its title suggesting Mother Nature's opinion of Gilded Age values, is widely published in American magazines.
Thanks, Callum. There was a book 11 years before the Titanic that described its almost its size, its point.
One American with no
fear of
progress,
the purpose of getting from Europe to
the
United States.
Morgan.
And
the booming Atlantic
passenger it hit an iceberg.
His eye. He starts
and it was
a
like a slap in the face of the Gilded Age
owns,
that
and
feels
then makes
like,
attractive offers
you know,
to those British,
it's
European,
all about them.
And American lines who are
oh,
losing
Titanic,
money.
Oh, Titanic, I might actually know a little bit about
his international navigation company grows to become International Mercantile Marine. Morgan's desire to own a major British shipping enterprise focuses
so
on
I'll
the White
fast
Star
fast forward
line.
It a little bit.
In December 1902, he buys White Star for £10 million, 10 times its earnings in 1900. The liners continue to sail proudly under the Union Jack, but now an American hand rests heavily on the tiller. The White Star line flourishes with the International Mercantile Marine's backing. 1 year after the purchase, J.P. Morgan offers White Star's director, J. Bruce Ismay, the position of managing director and president of IMM and its subsidiaries. As the son of Thomas Henry Ismay, Bruce had taken charge of White Star 4 years earlier and impressed Morgan with his abilities and vision. The influence of the Ismay family on transatlantic passenger trade has come a long way since Thomas first purchased a failing business for a mere £1,000.
So Bruce Ismay, who's the guy on the Titanic that says in the movie, "What, this ship can't sink?" You know, the one that says, "I think it'd be great if, you know, we went to New York and arrived on Thursday rather than Friday," and all this. That's J. Bruce Ismay. His father bought the White Star line back in 1890-something or 1880-something for only about £1,000. So with more investment and such a history of the Ismay family being all about the mercantile marine era, whatever, this man is being appointed the president of International Mercantile Marine. What does that mean? Well, it's simple. The Titanic, the reason why there weren't enough lifeboats on board is because those rules did not account for all these big ships that were being made at the current times. The rules could not keep up with their demands of making things bigger, better, more passenger. So believe it or not, it was legal of Titanic to carry the amount of lifeboats that it had. So maybe it was because this president here didn't want to be having that deck bombarded. It's kind of like a conspiracy. So he was appointed the president of the same group that said, don't put more lifeboats. Let's go to the next one. And maybe I could skip all this where the Cunard, all these people just basically had a competition. What is this about? And here it is where they're talking about, okay, this is no longer about sending supplies across the fields. Let's do
will astound
comfort
the world with sheer
and astonishment.
That same
luxury.
Year, over a pleasant summer dinner
that's
in
not
London,
something that's ever been done before.
White Star's Bruce Ismay and Harland and Wolff's Lord William Peary conceive a new line of ships. They envision the largest moving objects ever made by man. Three liners to surpass both Cunard and their German rivals. At 45,000 tons, these ships will be 50% bigger and 100 feet longer than anything yet built, able to carry more passengers to America than ever before. These three liners will be constructed to lure the world's wealthiest travelers with their magnificence. They will be called Olympic, Titanic, and Gigantic.
And Gigantic. which was later called the Britannica. Britannic. Let me pause it again. So, what was I about to say? Damn it. So now they're going into business for doing these three ships that have never been done before, where they're focused on better food, better conditions. They're not cramped spaces. The whole point is to make it a nice, pleasant experience to go across the Atlantic Ocean. So that's what they do. So now they put the contract in for the Wonder Ships. It's all signed. Here they are making the thing. Let's skip over a few more. Because what's really cool about this CD and all of its history is that it shows parts of the Titanic movie that no one's ever seen before.
In 1909, all ships need to carry lifeboats, but not everyone agrees on how many. Though final plans for Titanic and Olympic call for 16 boats each, plus four Engelhart collapsible boats that can be stored more easily. Designer Alexander Carlyle originally saw 48 and possibly even 64 boats per ship, using new davits by the Welland Company. Bruce Ismay disagrees with Carlyle, claiming that 48 lifeboats will take up too much deck space and cause passengers to worry. In the end, 20 boats with a total of 1,178 seats are considered adequate for 3,547 passengers and crew.
That's another
thing. In fact, Titanic and Olympic will actually exceed the outdated British Board of Trade requirements by 17%. But this still isn't enough lifeboats to accommodate every passenger.
Exactly. So when the Titanic set sail on its maiden voyage, it was actually severely under capacity. That's actually a good thing, right? Because 1,500 people died, 700 people survived. That's 2,200 souls on board. But it was capable of holding over 3,000. So let's see what this is all about.
On May 31st, 1911, Lord and Lady Peary, both celebrating birthdays, host a group of distinguished visitors in Belfast for the launch of Titanic. Aided by 23 tons of soap, tallow, and train oil spread on the slipway, the ship slides easily into the River Lagan, reaching 12 knots
and coming to a gentle stop one minute later.
She is then towed to the fitting out basin for completion. Shipworker James Dobbins had been fatally injured by a falling support during Titanic's launch.
Yeah, the first death.
Unaware of the mishap, White Star officials celebrate over lunch, accept the now completed Olympic, and sail her to Liverpool to prepare for her maiden voyage.
Liverpool! So here's where they explain it is of complete good technology.
Like the Olympic,
that it's
Titanic's
unsinkable.
Safety features set new standards for marine technology. Harland and Wolff has given Titanic a double-plated keel and a system of watertight compartments that allow any two of them to flood without sinking the ship. Alternately, towards the front of the ship, she would be safe if any three of the first five compartments were to flood. Even in a worst-case scenario, if every single one of the first four compartments were to fill with water, the ship could conceivably stay afloat. Should the hull ever be punctured in one or more places, electric watertight doors would close automatically. Powerful pumps will empty each flooding compartment long before water can reach the gaps between the top of the bulkheads and the ceiling plates.
Sorry, I'm on mute. So let me explain that too. The worst case scenario that can happen inside a ship like this is a head-on collision. I mean, you just ram the ship into something. That was considered the worst thing that can happen. Well, if that happens, it only hits about three compartments. Even if destructively the worst accident on the frickin' Atlantic ever happened, the first four would be filled up. And then guess what? They'd close the wider doors, they start the pumps, and they stay absolutely still, and they can still float to wherever they need to go. Like, for example, they'll get a ship, they'll empty out all the passengers, and they'll just get tugged to wherever they need to go. However, on that fateful night, five compartments were slid on the side. In other words, it would have been better if the Titanic just hit the iceberg head on than to hit it on the side, and it got several compartments. It got five. And that's what Thomas Andrew knew, that it was going to sink.
Shipbuilder magazine calls White Star's huge new ships practically unsinkable. In the public mind, this is as good as just plain unsinkable. Expectations for Titanic now run even higher.
They actually advertised it like that. As the unsinkable ship.
Even unsinkable ships can have accidents. As Olympic leaves Southampton on her fifth voyage,
we don't care. Let's go to the next one.
To the people of Belfast, the wonder ships that rise above the...
It made an incredible business for them. Obviously, they didn't do much in Belfast, so making these ships were
on
of
March
great
31,
pride.
1912, I love this song. Titanic, the world's largest ship, is completed. Her 882-foot hull is built of more than 2,000-inch-thick steel plates, held together by more than 3 million rivets. Two massive anchors will hold her in place, one for each side, with a third stored in reserve on the forecastle. 29 boilers drive her two colossal reciprocating engines and single turbine, generating up to 46,000 horsepower. Her displacement weight is 52,310 tons, even more than Olympic. The cost of building and fully equipping Titanic has come to £1.5 million, or $7.5 million, nearly $125 million by today's standards.
Actually, more now.
The White Star line anticipates a quick and glorious return on its investment.
It's probably $150 million today's times, because this was done in 1997. With all the inflation since 1997.
2 days after her completion, Titanic's officers conduct her sea trials in Belfast Loch.
So there they are. They're ready to sail. Let's see if we can get more here. Let's fast forward. Oh, so here's the first thing that you guys, they don't tell you. A more luxurious ship. Let's watch that first. Uh-oh. Let's go back. Let's go back, I say. There's the movie. Now it's the movie frames start coming in once they start boarding.
Wednesday, April 10th. Titanic's maiden voyage begins at noon, and the sailing hour draws near. After years of advanced publicity, and with the sheer size and elegance of its liners, White Star has at last created the spectacle it desires. Throughout the morning, Southampton fills with sightseers. The waterfront is lined with onlookers and well-wishers.
Here's something they don't show in the Titanic.
Everywhere.
Pictures are being taken.
Anticipation hangs tangibly in the air.
And here's a quick look at the
Titanic.
Titanic
is a wonder of modern marine engineering, but the general public is impressed by something else. Luxury. The grand staircase spans six decks with its graceful sweep of paneled and carved oak surfaces. Behind it are three elevators for those
who
choose
to
ride.
That's expensive. It's
the
one of the most expensive
glass staterooms and suites are elegantly appointed, and each suite has a private bathroom. Their occupants can dine in the dining saloon or in the a la carte restaurant. There are lounges for all, smoking rooms for men, a writing room for ladies, a library for second-class passengers. Those seeking exercise may visit the gymnasium, swimming pool, or squash court. Those in need of deep relaxation will find it in the Turkish bath.
The Turkish bath.
Second-class passengers can expect courteous, if less regal, versions of the first-class public rooms and personal services. Even the steerage passengers are given more privacy and better food than they might expect on a lesser ship.
Here they are. We are boarding the Titanic.
At 10 a.m., White Star's chartered boat train from Waterloo Station pulls up next to Titanic. In addition to travelers from London, The train also carries people from Liverpool whose ships have been docked by the coal strike.
Yep.
All begin to board the ship from special gangways that connect
the coal
directly
strike.
To the railway.
That's so important
carriages.
In this Titanic story.
Titanic's range of passengers is
some
like a
shots that you don't
of
see in the movie.
Society that has made her possible.
People arrive
whether
on horseback.
Whether they are magnates and heirs happy to spend thousands of pounds on a transatlantic jaunt,
like
or
Molly
humble
Brown.
People who have earned their passage to America
the
and the shops and mills
we
of the wealthy,
for lice to make
all
sure
are ready to entrust their lives
diseased.
To Titanic for the next week.
This is just so interesting to me.
Many of Titanic's second-class passengers hold first-class tickets for Oceanic or Majestic, less elegant White Star liners, whose voyages were canceled when their coal supplies were transferred
mm-hmm.
to Titanic.
Yep.
These are educated, middle-class people, like Lawrence Beasley, a vacationing science professor from London's Dulwich College. These are families en route, such as the Beckers, American missionaries returning from India. Their accommodations on Titanic, while lacking the famous grandeur and privilege of first class, will be as comfortable as any modern stateroom on another ship. Before Titanic sails, her second class passengers are allowed to tour the more luxurious areas of the wonder ship.
That was kind of cool. It's kind of like a ball game for a baseball game. You're allowed to see any spot in the ballpark, but then come game time, you need to sit in your seat in that area.
As the passengers board, Titanic's crew conducts a lifeboat drill under the watchful gaze of Captain Maurice Clark and other Board of Trade inspectors. Sailors at the davits swing out a few of the boats and lower them with junior officers and other sailors aboard. They disconnect the small craft from their falls and row out into the harbor. The simulated escape is complete, and the inspectors are satisfied. By legal standards, Titanic's lifeboats are now considered safe and adequate.
Let's see,
she is officially free to sail.
How about that?
At the stroke of noon on Wednesday, April 10th, Titanic's huge steam whistle bellows. Her lines are cast off, and she eases away from her berth. Passengers crowd the deck rails to wave their jubilant farewells to those on the dock. Photographers click away wildly. One newsman is thoroughly impressed.
The vision of the great liner as she moved away from Southampton Quay forms an imperishable memory. She looks so colossal and so queenly.
Five tugboats lead
shot.
Titanic through the channel of the River Test. History is being made.
But while she's even trying to get out of this little channel area, she is so big
Titanic's propellers
that she
turn
pulled
as the tugs
one
cast
of the ships
off their
towards her.
Her size and power
like
set up a strong
pull.
Current in the narrow,
but
crowded
it's just the
channel.
Swell.
A ship owned by the American line, the steamer New York, rises on Titanic's swell. As she falls, her lines break with sounds like gunshots. Her bow is sucked uncontrollably into Titanic's wake. Harbor pilot George Boyer reverses Titanic's engines at the last second. The tugboat Vulcan heads off the drifting liner, stopping her just 4 feet from Titanic's hull. Titanic waits for New York to be floated out of the way before cautiously proceeding. Now 1 hour behind schedule, she turns into Southampton water and makes for open sea.
See, not everybody knows that. I love these little stories that could have prevented the Titanic from setting sail as if that ship actually did hit the ship
the near collision
and
with the
affected
steamer
it in
New
some
York
kind of way.
Is an exciting
probably
send-off
wouldn't have sailed,
from Southampton.
You know?
But many of Titanic's passengers are too busy with their first lunch to watch
all
the
right.
maneuvers that follow.
So we'll keep on.
In the rhythm of shipboard life.
Let's see what else we got. Who's who? We know who's on board. We saw the movie. Francis Brown. Yeah. You gotta see this story.
One of the eight people to disembark at Queenstown is 32-year-old Francis M. Brown, a teacher at Belvedere College in Dublin who is studying for the priesthood. He has been snapping casual photographs during the trip from Southampton. His images are the last to show passenger life aboard Titanic as she was in April 1912.
Some of the few pictures that survived. Why? Because this guy left.
Oh.
And there's the movie. Do you remember the movie where the little boy is playing with the top and he's wearing like a little cap? And there's a guy, just, you know, a couple of men just watching over him or what have you, because it's his kid. That's why James Cameron put that in the movie, because of this picture that is known, that there was a boy playing with a top on the deck. That's why he included it. Second class passengers. So that's interesting. And another thing that's interesting, you don't see it here, but you see it in another thing, is that one of the other stories is that once they did arrive in Cherbourg, one of the male clerks who purposely said, yeah, I really want the job on the Titanic, I want to help deliver mail and pick it up and put it in the right room and all this, all of a sudden in Cherbourg, he does the mail, he puts it onto the land, he picks up more mail, puts it on the Titanic, and then he turns around to his co-worker and says, bye! And the co-workers are like, wait, where are you going? You're a mail clerk. You're supposed to stay here until we get to America. And he goes, no, I don't think so. I just needed a ride to France, and I knew this job would get me there. So thanks, bonjour. You know, merci, see ya, bye. He quit. If he didn't quit, he probably would have been dead, because one of the first things that went under was the mailroom. So the mailroom was one of the first things, along with the cargo room, to go underwater. So it might have saved his life quitting his job. That's amazing. Let's go. So what's next? We'll forward and start getting into better stuff. So we know about the immigrants. We know there were immigrants on board. Let's see what else is here. We know about the wireless room. We know about that. They get the first ice warning. Wait. But Ismay urges the captain to speed up. So I'll explain this scene in just a second.
The next afternoon, Saturday, Mrs. Elizabeth Lyons overhears a telling conversation between Bruce Ismay and Captain Smith.
Elizabeth Lyons, which says it here, the testimony of Elizabeth Lyons. In other words, she said this in a court of law in one of the gazillion inquiries. This is her. That's why James Cameron put her in the back of the film, because you'll see her eyeing all of this. She overheard the conversation of Bruce Ismay talking to the captain about speed
check or anything in these things. It's because it's all fiction. Their story is completely fiction. I mean, there's small tales where they or have some facts with them, but majority of it is fiction. So that is the end of volume 2, and I'm going to end the stream to start playing some DVD because it's 9 o'clock at night. But I thank you all so much for joining me on this little mission here. Ooh, it ejected my CD. Get out. Okay, so I'll switch over and get rid of this display, because it's a very old disc. It's from 1997. I had to use an external drive in order to play it, because it's just too old for modern PCs. So got that going. Yeah, so some really disturbing stuff, right? But it's tales that needed to be said. And a few things that you guys didn't see. Like I said, this thing deep dives into Titanic stories. Another thing that it didn't talk about was the story of there were two women that were boarding boarding the boat, and they're very religious women. Well, apparently the coding on Titanic was 04, I forgot the numbers of the coding, but the lady saw the coding on the ship on her way inside. So she's like boarding the ship, she'll see it. But in the water, in the reflection, even though the code, let me see if I could look it up real quick online, I'll tell you what those numbers are. But she saw the code upside down and it read, no Pope. So the number was, let's see, I'm sure one of these people will say it. It's 60604. But if you read it backwards on the whole number, it would say, no Pope. So if you read that backwards, it's no Pope. It's when viewed in a mirror, its actual serial number was 104. Let's see what it says. Hold on one second. It was a couple of Protestants. That's what it says here. I accept your cookies. Just tell me the code. Code 04. Its actual serial number was 104. Chosen after Chief Designer Sir Carson Craig. One feels there is zero chance of four counties filling up with Catholics. So when she saw the words no Pope or no Pop or whatever it may be, she refused to get on the Titanic. And her other friend also said that she goes, I can't believe that she didn't board because of that, but she followed her friend. And who knows if they would have survived or not. I think there were a couple of second-class passengers. So who knows if they would have passed away or not. But it's these little stories that you read in this series that I think is just absolutely remarkable. It's absolutely incredible. So here's a quick video from James Cameron, and I'll stop the stream. Thanks for watching, guys. No, where's my video? I didn't do the video. How dare you? It's probably because I didn't have the CD in, because it kicked it out. All right, guys, we'll call it a day. All right, thank you so much, and I will switch over to DVD. And we'll see you in a little bit. Thanks for watching again, guys. Romy, signing temporarily offline. I'll be right back. Bye.